So welcome all of you to the topic four session in this afternoon. And we will talk about educational sustainable forests, forest products utilization, and wood culture. And our session will contain seven presentations from different parts of the world. And we'll also have a break and then two more sessions. I would like to welcome Dr. Andrea Weber. She's from Austria and she has studied at the University of Natural Resources and Life Sciences in Vienna. And her presentation will be the keynote speak, wood knowledge for further generations. Please, Andrea, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Elisabeth, for introducing me. Thank you very much to the organizers for inviting me. For me, it's a great honor having this talk here. I'm trying to start my presentation now, so I hope you can see it in 1 minute, in 1 second. As it is the keynote for topic four, I will try to make a very general talk. And I ask you to think with me and discuss with me if our children and if young people might be able to change the future situation, that means if they are able to stop climate change, stop the loss of culture, and what we can do as grown up, if we can guarantee a sustainable future with the help of education. So Elisabeth started to introduce me, but I want to tell you something about me so that you can weigh my arguments. So my studies was about wood. I was studying wood science at the University of Applied Life Science in Vienna. And I was working at university and working in wood research. And at that time, wood became very much important to me. I love wood. I like to work with wood. And on some point, I realized that I also love to talk about wood, to talk about wood to people who have another background. And so I started a pedagogical training, and I soon realized that there are many children who know very little about the material wood. And in the curriculums of primary and secondary schools in Austria, the topic wood is not even in the curriculum. So that's the point when I became self-employed with wood pedagogic. So I started working with very little children from the kindergarten on, so elementary school, and telling them stories about woods and forest, going out to the forest, take the wood they can find there and make something out of it, and later make experiments. The other job is that I'm a teacher at a high technical school. So I train young people who want to work in the wood industry. So I'm really happy with my job because I can start with children from 3 years on to grown up to work with them on the topic of woods. And the next slides, I'm trying to show you a little bit about my work. And first, I tell you very briefly something about Austria, for those of you who might not be in Europe. So also that you can weigh my arguments. Austria is in the middle of Europe, in Central Europe. It's a very tiny country. So we have only 84,000 square kilometers. So in comparison to Germany, who has 367,000 square kilometers, and Italy, 301,000 square kilometers, we have only almost 9 million inhabitants, but Austria is very rich in forests and we have a very long tradition in woodworking, and wood is a very important economical point. So 4% of the global export of sawn timber comes from Austria, and almost 300,000 people are employed in the forestry and timber industry. Just to compare it to other sectors, there are 248,000 people in healthcare, 246,000 people in mining, 203,000 people in hospitality. And one point is that most of wood industry is situated at the countryside. And this might be similar in your home country because you use a lot of space and you usually build wood industry close to the forests. But I want to stick to that point for a minute. Traditionally, at the countryside, there's a lot of farmers industry, agricultural industry. But nowadays, young people go to university because they want to have another future than their parents had. And once they are well educated, they have to leave the countryside because they do not find an appropriate job there. But on the other hand, wood industry has a lack of high qualified employees and would be an interesting employer in rural areas. But the problem is that often children do not even think about choosing a profession connected to wood. So why could it be? And there is just one try to explain it. In former times, the knowledge about wood utilization was given to one generation to the next, and even children helped to repair the fence and even to build a house. So they learned a lot by just doing, and they learned a lot from their parents, from their neighbors, from their sisters, and therefore it was not necessary to teach how to use wood at school. But today we have a completely different situation and we have to start teaching forestry, teaching wood. So that's just one point from Austria, and I want to bring it in a global context. So you all know the Sustainable Development Goals from the UN, and I guess you all know that wood can do a lot to reach those aims, those goals. So if we go to climate change, and I think it's the main topic of this conference, we all know that wood reduces the CO2 emission, and wood can do a lot for life on Earth. But here I want to stick a little bit on topic number 11. So sustainable cities and communities. Of course, wood is a sustainable building material. And what I want to talk here is in public buildings, you often have projects which are not realized with wood. They are realized with other materials. And that's because of the high price of wood. But if you look into the situation more in detail, element, drying time, you have wall thickness. If you have building time, it's the same because you can use it, make more out of the space. So we have to train people who are going to make the decision in the future. We have to train them now so that especially in public areas where there is a lot amount of wood needed, and we go to education and tell people and train people so that those decision makers will decide to use more woods in future. And if we read about 4.7 of these goals, there you can see that it's written, ensure that all learners acquire the knowledge and skills needed to promote sustainable development, including, among others, through education for sustainable development and sustainable lifestyles, human rights, gender equality, promotion of culture, of peace and nonviolence, global citizenship, and appreciation of cultural diversity and of culture's contribution to sustainable development. So, what can we do? How can we train the future generation. And if we want people to live in a sustainable way, as it was written, we need people who have built up a relationship to themselves, to other people, and to nature. Because you usually care for those things you have a relation with. And I want to point out that forest and wood are particularly good subjects for teaching basic relationships between people and nature. And it starts at a very early point in the kindergarten. You can just play it. You can just make trees. They love trees. And if you play and say you cut the trees and then the truck comes and brings it to the building site, brings it to paper industry and brings it to sawmills, you also have to plant new trees, because otherwise the next generation will not have trees to use. So it's the very basic meaning of sustainability. So it says sustainability in the means of forestry, and it was the basic meaning of sustainability, is that you use the forest and you do not use more than which is growing, so that the future generation can use the same amount you are using at the moment. So we should not forget that education has the power to form children. And of course, this can be done in a negative way, but of course, we want to do it in a positive way. And here I just want to mention two pioneers of education. It's Maria Montessori and Rudolf Steiner, who advocated a strong community ethics. And Montessori saw the child as the constructor of civilization. And I want to go one step further. I see the children as the constructors of future. And there are a lot of models of children development. And here again, I want to stick to those of Maria Montessori. She wrote about sensitive faces, and she mentioned that from birth on to the age of 3, children are just absorbing their surroundings. And when they go to kindergarten, they start to analyze their experience. They start to analyze their surroundings and they start to categorize. So they categorize what is good and what is bad, what is wrong and what is right. So here we can do a lot by helping them to see what is wrong and what is right. So they learn a lot by imitating, and we as grown up can show them how to live in an appropriate way, and so they will imitate it. Then next step, they go to school and they develop moral worth. And they are very much inspirable for nature. And they use nature as a field of exploration. And at that point, they learn very much to satisfy their parents or their teachers. So again, it's very important that we live this moral, and that we live this moral so that children can see it and copy it. From the age from 12 to 18 years, they start to take responsibility for themselves and responsibility for their doings, and also for global problems. So they want to change something. They see the problem and they are part of the whole thing, and they try to find solutions. And if you think about your life or the life of your friends, our lives increasingly becomes more digital, and we spend a lot of time indoor. We decreasingly spend time outside, but we still want to have the relationship to the nature. And time in the nature is so important to get grounded and to build up relationship to nature. And fortunately, nothing is easier than getting grounded and having the relationship to nature, because you just have to go out. You go out to the forest and just lay on the ground. You can smell it, you can feel it, you can see it. And so this should be done, and this is done with children to build up the relationship. And in Austria, there's a strong community with forests pedagogics, and they do it. They go out with children to the forest, they lay down, they have all the sensual experiences. So the children have the first step of building up a relationship to the nature. And the next step, if you have built up a relationship, is that you are very interested in what you have a relation with. So you want to learn something. And if you have good people telling students how long it lasts till a tree can be harvested, what does a tree need to grow? So children will be able to change something. And the next step is out of the forest, and we go to the woods, and we want children to see wood as a sustainable material. But children should also see wood as an economical potential, and they should use modern technology. So it's not enough just going to the forest and breathing and feeling the forest. You should see, if you stay in the forest, you see the trees, and with the trees, you see the woods, and wood, you can build something out of it. And if you build something out of wood, you can reduce CO2 emission. And if you like wood, if you love wood, you want to make the best out of it. So you need the modern technology to make the best from your trees you have harvested. So that's the basis for the children who will make the decision in the future. So what can we do as grown-ups? We can make experiments with wood, so the children, different species have to be used according to their specific properties, and we can tell students how our ancestors used wood for many centuries, because children will understand wood and avoid utilization in the future. There will be a good light to wood. So we'll draw a good picture of wood, and more people use wood. So let me show you some examples here where I'm the kindergarten swim, because wood is very light. And then you tell the children that in the cells, wood is able to transport water from the roots to the leaves. But once a tree is cut, then there is no water in the cells anymore. There is air in the cells. And because of this air, if you have a dry wood and you put some soap on one side and you blow through it, you get a foam. So what does it mean? For kindergarten children, it's very fascinating. But later they understand that wood is a material which has a natural insulation. So if you build with wood, you have insulation in the wood, and you can have smaller walls in the building. So you can use the air efficiently. And I let children hammer on the wood so that they see wood is very strong on the one hand, and wood is also very elastic. And we try to test the wood, that the whole group is allowed to break this little wood in the middle, and wood is very strong in tension, so they will not be able, although the whole group is trying to. And of course, the most important thing is that we show children that they can do something with the wood, and I give them a knife, and they're really happy that they're allowed to use the knife. And of course I help them so that they can make something out of the branch. And that's the next step. which is very important if you think about wood and education. It's the problem solving expertise. That's something which will get more and more important in future, because if we want to manage the challenges of sustainable development, we need people who have learned how to develop solutions to new problems. So we have other problems than our grandparents had, and we have to find solutions to our problems, and the next generation will have other problems, maybe bigger ones. And wood can teach children to gain this competence. Why? Because wood is easy to find. You just go to the forest and pick it up. And then it's easy to work with. You usually need not more than a saw and a knife. And so wood is perfect to find solutions and also to have ideas which can be realized. And here I want to introduce someone who touched me very much, who inspired me very much. It's Christoph Leuthard from Switzerland. He has founded the Bildungswerkstatt Bergwald, and I don't know how he, which English name he gave, but it's an institution about education in the very steep forest of Switzerland. And he has a very holistic approach of education. And he stated that sustainable development starts within us, with our relationship to ourselves, to our fellow human beings, and to nature as our basis of life. And we have just talked about the relationship to nature. And now we want to look for the first step to the relationship to ourselves. And he's working with children, with young people, and he is allowing them to go to the forest, and he works with real life work. So they cut trees, and not small trees, but they cut really big trees in this deep area, and they build trails, and they do all the work usually trained people do. And that's a real life job, which really physically exhausting, and they often reach the border, and that's what young people often need, or what they look for. They look how to reach their borders and how far can I go, and this strengthens the character and the personality. And another point is the relationship to others. So often you need a team, you need teamwork, because you can reach something with a team you could not reach by your own. And then you see yourself in the mirror of the team, in the mirror of your fellow beings. And this is a very important experience for young people just growing up and trying to find their goals, their aims, and try to find out who they are. And that's my last point of this talk, is about saving wood culture with education. It's also one important point of the World Wood Days, saving the culture. And I try to show you how you can keep culture and with the help of education. So this might be one of the big advantages of our time, that we can use a lot of techniques. And if we realize that we have a loss of culture and a lot of historical woodworking techniques seem to die, nowadays we still have people who are able to work in these historical techniques, but they are often very old, and we can save this knowledge by making videos, putting them on YouTube or making a description on the internet. But then it's of course very important that we do it in a proper way, that we have a very detailed very detailed the tools and all working steps. So you have to picture how the hand works and how what the hand does. And there's one YouTube channel of Michael Grabner. He was the organizer of the World Woods Day 2019. And some of you who have been there might remember the reconstruction of the mill in Stübing. And there is a reconstruction video also in the English language so that you really see every step and might be able to reconstruct it. And there is another site which you also will know. It's oldest wooden objects where you can see all objects worldwide who are dated, which are dated and which are scientifically worked on. And that brings me to the conclusion. So the conclusion about what can we gain by education. Education is part of the solution, to reach all the goals we have for a sustainable life. Children are part of the solution because we educate them and we can guarantee that children might have another position and might be able to decide our future. And a good relationship to nature is part of the solution. A good relationship to ourselves and our fellow beings is part of the solution. And of course, technology is part of the solution. So let us look positively into the future. And thank you very much for listening. So I think I'm a little bit too early, but I'm looking very much forward to the discussion.
For this fascinating and interesting presentation, it's really a pleasure to know that there will be a future education also in the field of wood culture. We have this pedagogics in the forest, so for the children, but not related to the wood. And when I was a child, it was the proud of each child to have a pocket knife for carving. But nowadays, the parents are so afraid to leave a knife in the hand of the child that this is not common anymore. And so I think you are the pioneer in Austria and I think also in Europe to teach not only something about the forest, but also about the wood and the use of wood. I think it's very important. Are there some questions? I will look at this. No, it's only that is a fine presentation. Are there questions from the audience?
Please. Yes, yeah, I'm Yafeng from Beijing. Actually, on behalf of the IWA as well and myself, to congratulate these very good presentations, very impressive. So I have the comment. So as we know, with the development of our society, the wood is meet with a very big competition from other materials like plastic, metal, and even concrete. And I think this presentation gives a very good suggestion for the people, especially who live in a city area, to provide a good link for the young generation to the wood, how to get the wood, knowledge of the wood, and how to find a good feeling from the wood. My question or the comment is maybe not only for the young generation, even for the adult people, yeah. We probably need to give more work, provide more work, the help for them to understand the wood. Do you have any good suggestion to the UFRO, to the IAA or IAAS, such kind of international organization. What is the good strategy for those international organization to distribute the old knowledge, the old culture for the public? Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah, we are fighting in Austria at the moment because it's very new that I think Elizabeth knows the forest education system is a little bit longer existing, but to look at woods and wood properties and try to teach children what wood means and how you can use it, this is quite new. Although, as I've told you, Austria is such a wood-rich country and has such a long tradition. And there is a community now who is trying to foster this idea. And I hope it will be the future in Austria. But I would be very interesting how it is in other countries. How is there any institution who is trying to foster this? Or is it also not so important in school systems? We don't have it in the curriculum.
Myself, Dr. Lalit from India. I just have to add a few things in what you said. In our school curriculum, I was a teacher. I taught from class 10th to 12th. Then currently I'm teaching BSc and MSc. That is, I'm assistant professor right now. But in each step in India, we have curriculum related to the protection of the forest. Two or three quotes are always been quoted in majority of the books in India, right from India. If we look back in 17th century, India had a rich tradition of protecting the forest under religious beliefs. That is a sacred, we call it that sacred forest. In 17th century, Amrita Devi Vishnoi was a village woman who protected the trees from being cutted by the soldiers, and she hugged the trees with her two daughters, and then she was cut with the axe of the soldiers in 17th century. It's a sorrowful event at that time. Since then, Vishnoi community protects the forest as a sacred groves in Rajasthan in India. And then in northern India, right from Rajasthan to Uttarakhand and another part of India, that is Gaura Devi protecting, she protected the forest. Then in Meghalaya, another part of India, the Khasi tribes are there who are protecting the forest like this. So India have a deep tradition of protecting the forest, the woods and the cutting of the trees because of the religious beliefs. And these things have been added in the curriculum of right from the beginning for second, third class till higher education in India. And I always teach the nature and that the students about the nature, not to cut the trees. And I was really impressed by what you were talking about. You started with Montessori, Maria Montessori. You started with the ABCD of the wood protection and the forest protection. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
There's a question. I will read it. Thank you for the nice presentation. I would like to know from your experience, how the children feel when a tree has to be cut, while they need to solve also the trees forest as a major social idea that is always passing on the media. Mm-hmm. Can you say something to this question?
I can say something, or maybe you want to say something, because Elizabeth is very much in forest pedagogic, but I have learned that there are really children who are very sad if you cut a tree, because you tell them that they were grown for 100 years or for 50 years. And if the trees are cut and fell down, then it's sometimes it might, or it can be a shock for the children. But I think if you tell them and if you work on it as wood, what wood can do, and that wood is growing and it doesn't die, but we can make something out of it and we make products out of it. And so it doesn't die, but it lives on and goes further by having a house built out of woods, or having the paper, having other products, then the wood still lives in this product. So this might be a bit pre-work before you go to the forest with the children having a tree cut. And I think
just may I add, at 20 years ago, this was also the case in many parts of Austria. So wood was very accepted and beloved, but when you started to cut the tree, so not only the children, but also the grown up, they said, no, we cannot do this. And this was the beginning of this forest pedagogy that to inform about the sustainability. And also, for instance, in Austria, there are more trees growing than there are cut. So to inform the people and the population about this sustainable management and sustainable management. And this also, of course, includes the use of wood. If there are no more questions, as I can see, Andrea, I would like to thank you very much for this very interesting presentation. Thank you and good luck for your future work to educate the children and to pass also the traditional knowledge about wood culture to the young generation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.